Lifts have come out. They hang like tree insects or swift sloths. They're the agents of an extraordinary environmental change. The workplace now aspires to be a fairground, a site of bodily intoxication.
When this old world starts getting me down, and people are just too much for me to face, I climb way up to the top of the stairs, and all my cares just drift right into space. On the roof it's peaceful as can be, and there the world below can't bother me. Let me tell you now, when I come home feeling tired and weak, I go up where the air is fresh and sweet. I get away from the hustling crowds and all that rat race noise down in the street.
The most recent generation of tall buildings is defined not by anything so blatant as an architectural style. There is neo-medieval for the first time in 75 years. There are homages to Gotham City. What links these buildings, irrespective of their appearance, is more basic than style. Volitional vertigo is to the late 20th century what the sash window was to the late 17th century or central heating to the late 19th century. A craze, a token of modernity that transcends style, function, and location. The craze probably started here in London at Richard Rogers Lloyd's building. It has become the architectural trait of the approach to the millennium. We're talking about the introduction of reason into structures which are otherwise exemplars of rationally applied science. Lloyd's is many things. It's a celebration of its own technology. It's a tour de force of the picturesque. It's also a major work of sensory dislocation. It delights the eye, but it chills the spine. Like everyone else, I used to think that the major influence on Richard Rogers was Meccano. I now realize that it was Edgar Allan Poe. Like a Poe story, this building draws you in, then releases in you fears that you never knew you had. It's the product of a Gothic imagination which wants to bring innocence to the edge of an abyss. Being at the top of Canary Wharf is like being on a tethered airplane. This is a rare experience in Britain, less so in the United States or Hong Kong or Europe. Indeed, Britain probably possesses the most horizontal cities in the world. Our spatial sensibility is out of step with everyone else's. This was not always the case. The great Gothic cathedrals were expressions of structural ingenuity, certainly. But they were also God's space on earth, temporal analogues of paradise, trailers for the forthcoming attraction called heaven. Fear of God was the stick, his sumptuous palaces were the carrot.
Santos Christus.
The immensity of a nave, easily the biggest enclosed space that a person would ever see in an entire medieval life, was an instrument of propaganda through scale. It dwarfs humans, renders them tiny in the scheme of things. It was a brutally literal means of proclaiming God's might. Even though few of us remain enthralled to that god, the instinct remains to engineer structures which diminish man and terrorize him and measure him against the world. You might even go so far as to wonder if God wasn't dreamed up simply in order to justify this exercise of power. The desire to create vertigo came first, and it gave us wings of invention, the spur to theism. Something, after all, must have occasioned that first time when humankind began to believe that there was somebody up there. I mean, the greatest of all the fairies at the bottom of the garden didn't appear out of thin air. Vertigo and the structures that provoke it are insolubly linked with religious extremes, religious fervour. But the visions and the fervour and the delusions don't have to be religious. In a godless age, they can be guiltlessly enjoyed or loathed for sensation alone. They don't have to have transcendent meaning grafted onto them. Stripped of all such baggage, vertigo seems pure, concentrate. Vertigo for vertigo's sake. That's the ticket. God!
Sure.